takes two to explain. And the talk will be given by Netanel and Dudi. Netanel will do the theory part for the first half an hour, and then Dudi. We will not take questions in between, just at the end. And Netanel, please.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for arranging this duet. Can you hear me in the back? Do I need this speaker? Okay, so I'm going to describe basically a proposal, and it's me and the colleague of mine, Terry Rudolph from Imperial College, put forward to basically produce special kinds of photonic states, photonic states that are entangled, which could be useful for performing quantum computation. And Dudi will explain our basic experimental demonstration of this proposal. So here is our outline. So I'll first very briefly talk about quantum computing, discuss the specific state and its properties. This state is called a cluster state. Then I'll explain how this cluster state can be used to perform something called measurement-based quantum computation. And I'll then explain our proposal for this quantum knitting machine. And Dudi will explain the experimental realization and all the specific experimental details. Okay, so let's start with discussing quantum computation. So you know, the broad stroke, quantum computation is really just preparing some initial state, some generic initial state, say all of the qubits in some state zero, applying some unitary process on this initial state, and then performing some measurements. These are the basics. In practice, it's very very convenient to express any quantum computation in terms of a circuit, and it's very reminiscent of what you know from classical computing, where we use gates, we use logic gates between bits. Here we use gates between qubits. A qubit is just a two-level system. So as in classical computing, we might have a single qubit gate or two qubit gates. Now, a very natural question to ask is what type of gates are sufficient to perform any kind of quantum computation we need? And what you could show, this is shown by Kitayev, that you could actually use if you have the ability to perform any single qubit gate, and you also have the possibility to perform a specific two-qubit gate, which I'll now explain, then you're good, you're golden. You can perform any quantum computation that you want. This is universal, okay, in this sense. Okay, a single-qubit gate is just a unitary rotation of a qubit, single qubit. And let me explain now what is this two-qubit gate. So I'm talking specifically about something called a controlled phase gate. This is the name, if you want. And I'm now going to give you the proof table for this specific gate. So, it's a two-qubit gate, so there's two qubits in the input. And it goes as follows. If both of these qubits are inputted in the state zero, the circuit does nothing, okay? If one of the qubits is in the state zero and the other one in the state one, the circuit does nothing again. The other way around, also, if the first one is in the state one, second one in state zero, nothing happens. But if both of them are in the state one, then the sign of the wave function is flipped, okay? Now, you may brush this away and say, okay, it's a minus sign, usually make this, throw them away anyway, but this minus sign is a very crucial minus sign. And the reason it's a very crucial minus sign can be seen by considering what happens when you put in the inputs of these, at the inputs for this gate, a superposition of 0 and 1. So for each one of these, for each one of the qubits, I'm going to put a superposition of 0 and 1. I'll denote this by plus, okay? This is just a shorthand notation. One minute calculation shows that if you just multiply out these two states, this is a joint state of the two qubits. It's a product state, but it can also be written as a superposition of all possible combinations, okay? Now, if you put this through the gate, as we discussed, you only flip the sign of this part, of the 1-1 part. So this is the result you get out, and then you can easily convince yourself that this is the output state, okay? Now if you look at this state, you see it's a superposition of two orthogonal components, and what this is really, it's a maximally entangled state, okay? So this sort of state you know, do all the things we like talking about, you know, it would give you a maximal violation of bed inequalities, it could be used to perform teleportation, etc. Okay, I'm not going to go into these things, but I just want you to remember that two qubits, when I insert these inputs, I get out a maximally entangled state. Okay, so now, one take-home message from this is that if we need, indeed, this two-qubit gate during the quantum computation, then we are actually, during the quantum computation, we're necessarily generating entanglement, okay? Because we're applying these entangling gates as we go along, okay?
But that gate doesn't necessarily entangle.
It doesn't necessarily entangle, but generically, you could show that, for example, if you run an algorithm, like Shor's algorithm, you generate entanglement. Okay, I'm not going to go into the details, but... Okay. So now these two gentlemen, Hans Grigo and Robert Rosendorf, asked the kind of dual question. Suppose somebody already hands you, you know, a multi-qubit entangled state. Okay, so this is a resource. Somebody just gives it to you for free. What do you need to do in order to use this state to perform quantum computing? Do you need less than what we needed before? What they showed is that if indeed you're handed a multi-qubit entangled state, a specific one which I'll now describe, as a resource, then all you need to do to perform quantum computing is to just go and measure your qubits one by one. Okay? And this is something that's considered easy to do. We don't ever need to do a joint measurement of two qubits, which is considered hard. Okay? So they call this measurement-based quantum computing. Okay, we only need measurements, but we need this state as a resource. Okay? So now you could ask, what is this magic state that allows us to do this measurement based on computing? And the state is actually a very simple state. Now just define it now. Okay? So the state, as I said, is the state of many qubits. So we just consider a bunch of qubits. Say here I plotted six qubits. Each one of the circles denotes a qubit. And let's start each one of these qubits in the state plus, the state I just defined, okay, 0 plus 1. And now you could choose, let's choose some lines connecting these nodes, okay, these circles. You could choose any number of lines you want. Different choices leads to different states, okay? But here I've chosen some specific lines connecting, specific graph connecting these six qubits. And for each, between each qubit, two qubits which are connected by a green line, I'll apply a controlled phase gate. The one I just described, I'll apply a controlled phase gate on these two qubits. Okay? So I'm just going to apply a controlled phase here, here, between these two qubits, between these two, and between every two qubits that are connected by a green line. And I get some state, some quantum states of many qubits. This is an entangled state. You cannot write it as a product state of all these qubits. And again, this is a family, it's a whole family of states, because for each graph I define here, I'll get a different state, okay? But it's a state of many qubits. Okay, so now, how do we use this, I'm going to describe how to use this state to perform this measurement-based quantum computing. And one basic ingredient actually goes back to something that was known by Schrödinger. If you have a two-qubit maximally entangled state, okay, which is the cluster state of two qubits, as I've just described in the beginning. If you measure one of the qubits, okay, you could choose what would be the state of the other qubit after the measurement by choosing which basis you measure, okay, you know, by rotating your Stern-Gerlach apparatus, choosing the direction. Specifically, I'll be interested in a one-parameter family of state of measurement bases, which are denoted by the equator of the sphere. Okay, don't need to go into more details than that. And now you could show the following thing. I'm not going to prove this, but basically, now if you consider this cluster state say, of four qubits. By measuring these four qubits one by one and choosing appropriately the basis of measurement in each stage, I can project the last qubit on basically any rotated state I want. I could rotate I could basically apply any unitary matrix I wish on the final state And you know, a rotation of a qubit is parameterized by three angles, right? These are three Euler angles. And just, you know, at least you have the correct number of parameters. I'm not going to go through the calculation, but you'll have to trust me. Okay, so I need to perform, to do three measurements, and then the final state is rotated in the appropriate direction. Okay, another interesting properties of these cluster states. So if you measure a one-dimensional cluster state, let's ask the following question. Suppose I measure all of the qubits except for two, right? I can ask, do I remain with a two-qubit entangled state? Okay, so I have a one-dimensional, very long chain of one-dimensional cluster state. And I go along and I just measure all of the qubits in the basis of my choice, the appropriately chosen basis. And you could show, I'm not proving this again, is that you could remain, by choosing correctly the basis of measurement, you could remain with an with the maximum entangled state on only two qubits you wish, okay? In arbitrary distant qubits. Okay? So what you can see here that in the cluster state, basically, quantum information can propagate to arbitrary distance, okay? Because any two qubits can basically be projected to a maximally entangled state. Okay, so how do we, by the way, this in the jargon, and Dudy is going to use this jargon, I guess, what you call this fact that the localizable entanglement, the entanglement can be localized on any two qubits, okay, at an arbitrary distance, okay? So now, if we remain for now with 1D chains, so, you know, we know that in quantum computing we need to evolve a single qubit, we need to apply single qubit rotations. And what I've shown you now is just basically by replacing time with this space direction, I could now basically apply mimic any time evolution of a qubit by basically just performing measurements and choosing correctly the basis. Okay, so how do we do a kind of full-fledged quantum computation? So here is some circuit. Suppose I want to implement this circuit. To implement this circuit, I would need to have a two-dimensional cluster state, something with kind of two-dimensional structure, where you see this would be my structure here, and these lines would correspond to kind of the time direction, time propagation of this qubit, and every time I have an interconnecting line, this would be basically implementing a two-qubit gate, and I could also implement a one-qubit gate by measuring in a appropriate basis over here. Okay, so I have this two-dimensional cluster state, and I choose which basis to measure at each one of the qubits. By doing that, I basically can mimic any quantum circuit I wish, therefore I could perform any quantum computation I want. Okay, so again, I'm not proving this, but you'll have to trust me. Okay? So far, I've just showed you that, you know, cluster states are great. You know, if you have them, all you need to do is to be able to measure single qubits and then you're done, okay? So how do we actually, but then you need something to give you this cluster state as a resource. How do we actually build them to start with? And in what system is it possible to actually build them? It's one very appealing system is photon. It's to try to build cluster state with photons or do quantum information processing with photons. The main advantage of photons is that they have very low decoherence. I mean, photons are very weakly interacting particles. They interact very weakly with their environment, and therefore they have very long coherence times. Okay? They're also very fast, so it's possible to do fast operations. You know, the fact that they also travel fast means that you have to also have very fast switching technologies, which might create difficulties. But the really, really, really nasty or limiting thing about photons, that, again, is that they don't interact. If they don't interact, it's very hard to do a two-qubit gate with photons, because two-qubit gate means that if it's a non-trivial two-qubit gate, that means you need these two particles to interact. Okay. So so performing this kind of this canonical circuit-based quantum computing might be hard because we need to apply two-qubit gates, and it's very hard with photons. However, what we're trying to do here in this experiment is actually to have a device which actually kind of build us a photonic cluster state, and then performing single qubit measurements on photons is very easy. Think about measuring polarization of a photon. That's basically what you need to do. And that's something we know how to do with very, very high accuracy. You know, we can benchmark it with classical optics if we need. So how do we actually build these cluster states with photons? So in 2009, my friend Terry Rudolph from Imperial College visited me, and we were thinking how to use the systems that David is working on to basically build photonic cluster states, and now I'll describe the scheme that we came up with. Okay? So I'm not going to go into the physics of quantum dots. Woody is going to do this for us. I'll just say that you could think about, for now, think about quantum dots as an artificial atom. But this artificial atom has very low symmetry for us. The only symmetry we'll need is time versus symmetry. Okay. And we're going to consider a typical level scheme in a quantum dot, which looks like this. So you have a set of two, basically, ground states, or Cramer pairs of ground states. We'll call them spin up and down. This is just a notation. For each one of these ground states, we also have an excited state. Okay, so there's two ground states, two excited states. The optical transitions between these ground state and these excited state is through a right circularly polarized photon. And between this ground state and this one, this excited state, are coupled via a left circularly polarized photon. Okay, so right circular photon couples these guys, left circularly polarized photon couples these guys. Okay? So now, if we have this level scheme, then, if I start with this spin up state, I excite it with a laser pulse and let it emit a photon, I'll end up with the spin up and right circularly polarized photon. Same way here, if I start with this spin down state, I'll excite it and let it decay, I'll end up with a spin down and a left circularly polarized photon. And if I have a superposition of spin up and spin down, I start with a superposition of spin up and spin down, and I excite it with linear polarization, okay? Then I'll end up with a superposition, basically with an entangled state of the spin and the photon. See, this is a superposition of spin up and right circularly polarized photon and spin down left circularly polarized photon. This is an entangled state. Okay? Now I could go on and repeat this, re-excite the quantum dot again, let it emit another photon. Then I can end up with this kind of Schrödinger cat state. Okay, this is not the state that we want. Okay, first, we can't use it to do any quantum computing, but it's also very fragile, very susceptible to decoherence. If some decoherence process happens to the spin, the coherence here will be lost. Now we need another ingredient, and it's a very simple ingredient. What we need is basically to add a magnetic field, say in the x-y direction, which will cause the spin to rotate, okay, to precess. Okay? And then, once you do that, you find the following scheme. So, I'll now give you a graphical representation of the scheme. You start the quantum dot, say, with this spin up, superposition of spin up and down. And then, you excite it and let it emit a photon. I'll explain this notation in a second. I'll just pictorially now use this black line to denote this excitation and photon emission. And then you let the spin just rotate, precess, because it's in a magnetic field. You let it precess until it precesses at an angle of pi over 4. Okay? And once it does that, you can check that now you have two qubits. You have the spin and the photon. You have a two-qubit entangled state in the same way I've defined before. Okay, so this is exactly the same notation, two circles and a line connecting. Now, if you repeat the same thing again excite and emit a photon, and then let it rotate for pi over 4, you can check that you end up with a state with three qubits, two photons and one dot. And now the state is a three-qubit cluster state, and so on and so forth. Note that each time we're adding a photon, we're adding it over here. Okay? So repeat this basically indefinitely and create a one-dimensional cluster state. The reason for this specific vector notation is that actually you could think about this as a quantum circuit, a big quantum circuit that creates this cluster state. So in the quantum computing language, this is a two-qubit gate, which is called a synod gate. Okay? But if you don't want to get into these details, you don't have to. You just remember that we have this repeated process that in each cycle, we basically excite the system and then let it persist, excite the system and let it persist. So actually, in the beginning, we didn't think about this knitting. It wasn't in our vocabulary. We thought about machine guns, okay? This is what it seems to us, but this didn't fly with the editor. And then Riegel actually suggested the term knitting machine. So now, the next topic I'd like to talk about, I'd like to talk about what happens in a more realistic situation, if we consider the fact that the quantum dot is actually, it's an open system, okay? It's coupled to its environment, it undergoes various decoherence processes, okay? So what I just showed you is a very idealized picture of what happens. In practice, you really have to take into account the actual physical process that's going on in this quantum dot. And one thing you might worry about, there's all this decoherence process happening during each cycle. So now, a natural question to ask is, okay, if this quantum dot is constantly going undergoing decoherence, and you're trying to emit more and more photons, maybe at some point you'll have to stop, because the system is just decohering too much, okay? It's too much decoherence accumulated, and you have to stop the process. So, you can ask whether the quantum correlations degrade as you make the state larger. The question answer is no. Instead, what happens is what I'll describe now, there's something called like error localization. Okay? What you get out is a cluster state, but with independent errors in each one of the photons, irrespective of the size of the number of photons, or the size of the cluster state. Therefore, you could repeat the process indefinitely, but remember that you all have these errors and you might need to do error correction on them later on when you try to use them. So let me just explain what do I mean by this localization of errors without being too technical. So here is our scheme, excitation and precession. And then at some point, kind of a bad process happens. There's some decoherence process that's happening. I'm not going to go into mathematical description of that. What you could show is that an equivalent representation of the state, okay, is to remove the decoherence process from this, okay, and instead put an error on two of the next subsequently emitted photons. Okay, so these two pictures are completely equivalent. But the nice thing about this picture is to see that the photon, once it leaves the system, it actually never interacts back again with the system. Okay, there's no line connecting this photon back again to the quantum dot ever again. It leaves the system and kind of takes out the garbage with it, and that's it. Okay, so each one of these photons will have some probability of error, but it's kind of an independent probability of error in each one of these photons. Okay, so what does this imply? For example, you could consider this issue of localizable entanglement, what we talked about before. Okay? And you could ask, okay, how much localizable entanglement do we have in this state with in the real system? Okay? So what you can show is that the localizable entanglement actually, it only depends on the distance between photons. So if I try to know what is the how much entanglement I have between two photons at the distance d, the localizable entanglement, the amount of entanglement between this one after I measure the rest, will depend on d. Okay, it will actually decay with d, but it would not depend on the number of photons in the state or on the position of these two qubits in the state. Therefore, the state has in some sense a translation invariance. Okay. So one last thing I'd like to conclude with and kind of pave the way for today. Is to ask, okay, so indeed, we once we have these decoherence processes, we need to replace this unitary description by something else. What's the mathematical description which replaces these unitary processes here? And the mathematical description, okay, once we add decoherence, is to describe one cycle of this protocol instead of what by unitary matrices by something called the process map. And I just now want to count parameters, because these parameters actually have been measured in the experiment, okay? So this map, what it does is actually, it maps the, what this process map is actually a map from the space of qubits, possibly mixed qubits, but this is basically the space of two by two matrices, so there's four Hermitian matrices, four parameters here, to the space of two qubits, density matrix and two qubits, which has 16 parameters. It's a 4x4 matrix. So all in all, you have 16 four-read parameters which describe this process, including the decoherence. Okay? And for example, this is the 64 parameters for the unitary case. Okay? And in the experiment that David is now going to describe, we actually measured each one of these parameters, each one of the 64 parameters. Okay, so we know exactly what is the state of the system at any time, because we could basically know the state is just defined by applying this map again and again and again. Okay. So now I have the floor to Dudi and to summarize quickly. So I've shown you that cluster states and measurements together, single qubit measurements, suffices to do quantum computing. I'll show you that quantum dots can produce 1D cluster states. We also have extensions to dimensions, which I didn't talk about. The number of the size of the state that you produce is not limited by decoherence. Its quality is degraded, but the size is not limited. And to really know what's going on, what state you produce, you really have to completely measure this process map that has 64 parameters.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Netanel. It has been a wonderful introduction. And it saved me from introducing to you very complex theoretical ideas. So, but this work actually, I've been working with Netanel actually for now 11 years or so. So, and this work was led to very nice results, I think, and probably others. So I will take from where Netanel finished, and I will try to explain to you how we realized these conceptual ideas, which when I heard it for the first time, this was 11 years ago, Netanel and Terry came to my office and tried to probe my mind with this crazy idea. We were struggling to show entanglement, and here he comes with a machine gun for entanglement. And I treated it as, you know, Chalomot Baspamia, a dream that will never come true. And 11 years later, it did come true. So let me describe to you how did this work. So I will start with just telling you what is this wonderful creature, semiconductor quantum dots, and then I will tell you more about the vehicles that we find in order to realize this wonderful idea. The original idea using the spin of the electron didn't actually work. And eventually I will try to show you how we realized this wonderful idea to have a source for quantum computing or communication. So again, Netanel described a two-level system. A two-level system is described usually as a point on a Bloch sphere, and this point on the Bloch sphere is also described by a 2x2 density matrix. But what we have to take from here, that once we come to the lab, in order to measure the state of a two-level system, we have to perform four measurements, okay? And four measurements are required, and when we measure a single qubit, that's a problem. One measurement kills it. So for now, just remember, we have to take four measurements. And when we talk about photons, a spin is described on a Bloch sphere. A photon is described on a Poincaré sphere. This is a elliptic polarization of a photon. And you can, there are two angles here, two angles here. So the Poincaré sphere describe the polarization of a single photon. It's also a two-level system. You can take a base of horizontal and vertical polarization, right and left polarization, diagonal and anti-diagonal polarization. Each one of these bases can describe this two-level system, but when we want to measure it, we have to project it at least on three independent directions. And one basis we have to measure twice, in order, on both the H and V, in order to know that our polarization is fully polarized. The point is not actually inside this qubit. So a photon is a flying qubit, and in order to measure the photon, we have to measure four times its polarization. Okay, we take it from here. So, but to measure polarization is relatively easy. And I think that was the motivation for measurement-based quantum computing. To measure polarization of a photon, everybody can do that. Okay? So the now we come to the quantum dot. So what's special about a quantum dot? Quantum dot is an ideal interface between spins to photon polarization. Really, there is nobody have demonstrated a better tool so far. And what is a quantum dot? A quantum dot is a piece of semiconductor, very small in dimension, nanometer size. It is buried inside one type of semiconductor, in this case in gallium arsenide, and here we have indium arsenide. Okay? The way we produce it, we simply grow epitaxial growth of indium arsenide, which has a lattice constant of 7% larger than gallium arsenide, and when it grows on gallium arsenide, it forms islands, just like because the tension is too high to continue to and grow epitaxially. So after one monolayer, we have droplets of indium arsenide. We then cover this indium arsenide with a layer of gallium arsenide, let the indium arsenide melt, this island melt, and we generate more or less quantum dots of the same height everywhere. And then we can put it in the machine and grow more. And eventually we generate a crystalline perfect material, which has inside of it a nanometer scale material of other properties. Okay? And this is a semiconductor, so we can grow it inside of a transistor, inside of a PN junction, inside of a microcavity. This is produced, this is actually the sample that we use. We have a layer of quantum dots exactly in the middle of one wavelength microcavity. We have a mirror here. This mirror is done by aluminum arsenide, gallium arsenide, quarter wave plate stuck here and here. And so these quantum dots emit exactly at one wavelength of in matter, in gallium arsenide is here. Okay? And that's the only system that you can easily do that. Okay? So these are our quantum dots. The advantages of quantum dots, I'll briefly count them. They live forever. They can be a part of electrical device, optical device. They can easily incorporate it to microcavities and devices, as I said. They're easily accessed optically and electronically. I can put a laser light on the same quantum dots for 3 years, and I have now maybe 4 or 5 graduate students who were studying 1 or 2 quantum dots. And the good thing about this easily access quantum dots is that their level separation is compatible with fast optics. The inter-level energy separation is few millivolts. 1 millivolt of energy is more or less a picosecond. The inverse of a millivolt is a picosecond. So we can use picosecond optics to manipulate these quantum dots, to excite them or de-excite them. This cannot be done with atoms. The atoms, the level separation is usually megahertz or kilohertz, and therefore the frequency by which you can affect them is much, much slower. Okay, and due to this, and we can easily charge and discharge, change the charge state of a quantum dots, and that's very, very important. So these advantages actually led to that quantum dots are sources of single photons. We have shown it for the first time, a graduate student from my Erez Dekel in a PRL from 1998, and we showed that they can generate entangled photon pairs. This was done with a copian, another graduate student of mine, and Netanel Lindner, when he was a graduate student here. The disadvantage of quantum dots are each dot is different. We can't yet control the growth so well that we can design 2 quantum dots which will be exactly similar to one another, like atoms. This is not the case. The other disadvantage, which is actually a great advantage, we discovered later, is that they are coupled strongly to their environment. Therefore, you can't decouple them. If you talk about a two-level system, you want the two-level system not to decohere, but by interaction with the environment. This cannot be done with quantum dots because they're part of a solid state. They're coupled to the environment with vibration, with phonons. But these phonons actually do not talk very efficiently to the spin, and therefore they are actually, in our case, they are an advantage. And we'll come to that in a second. So how do quantum dots act as an interface between spin and light polarization? the idea is the following. I'll do it briefly because it's important to understand. Okay, so you know that a semiconductor is composed of conduction band and valence band. The conduction band is made of S-like atomic orbital, and the valence band is made of P-like atomic orbitals that generate a band. And in a semiconductor at low temperature, all the states of all the electronic state in the valence band are full, and all the electronic states in the conduction band are empty. Therefore, they are semiconductors. At low temperature, they are insulators, and at higher temperature, when electrons move up, they can transfer electricity, energy, and so on. Okay, so the wonderful thing about our artificial atoms, the quantum dots, is that the higher energy state, the last energy state of the electrons in the quantum dots, have spin and orbital momentum which are parallel, okay, along the same direction. The other states are much farther away, and we can neglect them. Now, when we launch light into the system, for example, a left-hand circularly polarized photon on which is resonant with this transition, left-hand circular polarization have a minus one orbital momentum projection on the propagation direction. It takes an electron which has a plus one orbital momentum here and bring it to the conduction band where it has zero orbital momentum. And the conservation of angular momentum maintains. Okay? Photon do not couple to the spin at all. They only couple to the orbital momentum, to the atomic transition. And this is the case here as well. But here, due to the fact that by spin-orbit interaction, the momentum and spin are parallel here, the polarization of light choose the spin of the electrons that it promotes. Okay? So left hand take a spin up electron, and a right hand take a spin down electron, and a missing electron we use to call a hole, and the hole is opposite quantum numbers. Plus 3/2 hole electron is minus 3/2 hole, and therefore the polarization of the light is transformed into a pair in matter, a spin half electron in the conduction band and a spin minus 3/2 hole in the valence band. The total angular momentum is exactly the polarization of the photon, which was minus one in this case. And after recombination, we will get a sigma minus, so left-hand circularly polarized photon leaving the system, as you can see here. And this happens in a quantum dot within half a nanosecond. The dipole moment for optical transition is so large that the lifetime of this excitation is short, half a nanosecond. Right-hand circularly polarized light will generate an electron-hole pair with opposite direction, and they will recombine and emit this photon. These pairs, we call them bright exciton because they are coupled strongly to light. However, we can think about a situation in which the electron, after we've excited it, flip its spin and comes back to the quantum dot. And now the electron and hole spin are parallel. In this case, we have total spin of plus two. But this plus two cannot interact with light. And therefore, this exciton is called dark. It doesn't affect by light. And therefore, it lives much longer than half a nanosecond. Actually live more than a microsecond. Okay, so the energy level scheme of these two electron hole pairs, this excitation looks like that. The bright exciton, the two pair with plus one or minus one angular momentum have lower state, eigenset of symmetric spin combination and anti-symmetric spin combination, as you see here. And when we add the polarization sigma plus sigma minus here, we get here horizontal polarization, linear polarization, here vertical polarization. These are the optical transition of the bright exciton. That's how the dark exciton look, but here the energy difference between the two eigenstates is much smaller. okay? And actually, we were the first to show that we can control the spin, we can detect it, we can manipulate it. This was done by another graduate student of mine, Elon Cohen, in 2010, as shown here. Now, the nice thing about the exciton, for example, is that when you generate a spin qubit of an exciton, the spin qubit, unlike a spin qubit of a polarization qubit of a photon, is non-degenerate. There is energy difference between the lower energy state and the higher energy state. Okay? And this energy difference, what it causes is explained here, how we use light to write the spin. We use, if we take a picosecond light pulse, it excites both states. The energy separation here is much smaller than the energy separation here. A picosecond is a millivolt, this is a fraction of a millivolt, and it excites both states. But if we use this polarization, horizontal polarization, we excite this state only. This is an eigenstate, and it simply decays. The different polarization will excite this state, and it simply decays. Okay? But if we use right-hand circular polarization, now we generate this state. But this state is a coherent superposition of the two eigenstates, which have different energy. In a coherent superposition, the phase start to persist as a function of time, and the precession time is just the frequency times h bar is giving us the energy difference between the two states. And this, why this is so important, because we can have see precession without magnetic field. And that is why we were able to do what we demonstrate, okay? And let me go, and I'm running out of time, so let me switch gear here and tell you about measuring polarization entanglement, or measuring entanglement. How do we measure entanglement? As I said, to measure polarization of one photon, we need to measure four different measurements. To measure another photon, we have to measure another four measurements, and they should be independent. So altogether, we have to measure 16 different measurements in order to show that there is entanglement, polarization entanglement between two qubits. This is the results of our measurement from 2006, when we showed that a quantum dot produced entangled photon pairs. And you can see here that the first polarization is the first photon, the second one is the second photon, and you see we have 16 different measurements, independent measurements, that allows us to construct the polarization density matrix of the two qubits. And this is polarization density matrix of an unentangled two qubits. You see we have only diagonal terms. And when we used spectral filtering in this paper, you see that we have here non-diagonal terms, okay? And these non-diagonal terms evidence that there is entanglement between the two photons, the two qubits. Maximally entangled two qubits will have here non-diagonal terms that their absolute magnitude will be half. And this is called also negativity, if you want, which was invented by the late distinguished professor Asher Peres, one of my teachers in this faculty. Okay, so let me switch gear now in a second. Now, why the dark exciton is, can this is the electron scheme that Netanel described. Spin minus half is connected to spin minus 3/2. The state that he described by the sigma minus polarization, minus one, and spin plus half is connected to spin plus 3/2, okay, by generating another electron hole pair here, in red one. Okay. This is the pi system, the system that Netanel and Terry Rudolph suggested. We instead work in this system. This system contains a dark exciton here, electron hole parallel spin, plus two states. We add angular momentum of plus one by generating another electron hole pair, one here and one here, because it cannot be produced here. Okay, so plus two is connected to plus three. We call it a bi-exciton, there are two excitons here. And minus three is connected by a minus one to the minus three state here. This is our entanglement choice. And for reasons that I'll explain in a second, the first reason, we don't need here magnetic field. when we introduce magnetic field in Netanel scheme, the first thing is that you introduce magnetic field here as well. That's a problem. There are other problems, which I'll come in a second and explain. This is our dark exciton. It cannot emit a photon, but it can absorb a photon. And the absorption is demonstrated here. And after this absorption, which we perform by putting laser light in at resonance with the right polarization and the right intensity to make sure that we can do it in 100% fidelity or probability. And after we generated this state, now this state prefer to recombine here. And this electron hole pair recombine because the oscillator strength or dipole moment for this transition is 20 to 50% larger than for this transition. And the recombination occurs here at a different wavelength than the wavelengths in which we excite. And this is a huge advantage. That allows us to do spectroscopy. That allows us to measure the polarization of single photons when a laser light is resonantly exciting the system. A laser light is orders of magnitude more intensity than a single photon. Okay, and in order to do it, you have to have separation in energy, and that's let us do this experiment. In the schemes that Netanel and Terry suggested, the laser light and the emitted photon are at the same frequency. It's very, very difficult, if not impossible, to measure the polarization, to do polarization tomography. Another advantage is that after the first recombination occurs, now we have here an excited hole, and this hole just go down and return to the ground level. And it does it by coupling to phonon. And phonon, like photon, they do not couple to the spin. So this emission of a photon does not decohere the system. And now we have a dark exciton and we can use the system again. Okay, so that's the secret of our success. So this is our scheme, okay? Okay, so this is our scheme. The dark exciton is connected to its bi-exciton by this optical transition, analogous to the suggestion of Neteri and Netanel. But the excitation and radiation is not at the same frequency. Another big advantage, it has natural precession frequency. And this natural precession frequency is very, very slow when you compare it with the radiation lifetime. The precession here is 3 and 5 nanoseconds for this state and 5 nanoseconds for this state, and the radiative recombination occurs within 300 picoseconds, an order of magnitude faster. And why this is important? Because when we have this random process of radiative recombination, the qubit precesses. So because this is a random process, this destroys the degree of entanglement. Okay, so the faster we do the recombination, the less destruction of the degree of entanglement we will receive. That's what the Netanel refers to, imperfection, dephasing, and so on and so forth. Okay, so I can't describe, so the idea is almost there. I now go and describe the experiment in the next 10 minutes. But Netanel and Terry's proposal was put in front of us in 2009. It took us 6 years and more to demonstrate it. And the reason is that in order to show something in the lab, you have, there is a lot of technology, a lot of steps that you have to do in order to get there. And the steps are summarized here very, very quickly. So first of all, we discovered the dark exciton, which was a perfect candidate to do this. With an electron, we would have not succeeded. Other groups, very strong groups, tried and didn't succeed. Toshiba, for example. So we first measured its long lifetime, which was more than a microsecond. This was published a year ago by a paper by the first author is Ido Schwartz, one of my graduate students today. and he's, I think, today having his first daughter, should born any minute, so that's why he's not here. So I want to, that everything will be fine, and I congratulate him. Mazel tov. We measure it coherence time to be 100 nanosecond, also in the same PRX. We demonstrated on-demand initialization in any spin state using a picosecond optical pulse, like I demonstrated for the bright exciton. We can do it to the dark exciton. That's really a miracle. And this miracle was performed by Dan Kogan and Ido Schwartz, and published last year as well. We developed readout by optical projection on two different bases. That was also part of this PRX. So we can measure the dark exciton spin state on, okay, I'm getting there, on two different polarization. We can't measure it simply on a third one. We need three directions. A third one will require another photon. And so that's why it's more complicated. By easily, we can do it on two directions. And we developed a mean to reset the quantum dot. We can just erase, kill the dark exciton that remains there and make it ready to another measurement. Okay? And another tool that we developed during this year is a three photon correlation measurement tool, which is not so easy. In a second, you'll see why. And this was published by another graduate, student, Emma Schmidgal, who is now doing a postdoc in Seattle. Okay, so how we generate the entanglement? Now we just follow the proposal of Netanel and Terry. So we generate first, we create the dark exciton in this eigenstate with a phase here. We now, this, they are connected to the bi-exciton this way. We launch a horizontally polarized light, which contains the R and L with this given phase. This convert the dark exciton into a bi-exciton. It keeps the phase here. Now, this dark exciton recombine with him 300 picosecond, much before it has time to process. And when it converts, it generates this photon dark exciton entangled state. This is the state that we have. So now, all we have to do to excite it again, and again, and again, and this way we generate this GHZ state that Netanel refers to, which is not very useful, okay? Why it is not very useful? We lose one photon, or we want to trace out the exciton, which we cannot really measure, and we lose the whole entanglement. There are some other things that this is useful, but not for our guest. It's not a cluster state. So how do we make a cluster state? We simply wait between the excitation 3/4 of a period. Why we choose 3/4? Because we have detectors which are, their temporal resolution is limited. Therefore, we couldn't wait only 1/4 of a period of precession of 3 nanoseconds. We waited 3/4. We could have waited 5/4. There was no need for that. So when we wait 3/4 of a period, the plus state transforms into this state, and the minus state transforms into this state. We actually switch base. And when we do that, okay, now the state is described this way. And now we repeat the excitation, and repeat the excitation, and wait for the combination. And now we have a 3-qubit state, which is the beginning of a cluster state. Okay? And now all we have to do is to measure it to show that this is really a cluster state. One way of showing it is to, for example, to make this 3-qubit measurement by projecting the dark exciton on a +2 state. How we do that? We use a polarized laser. If the laser is polarized, right-hand circularly polarized, it will only excite this state of the dark exciton. And then if we, after that, detect a photon emitted, we know that the dark exciton was on the +2 state, okay? So if we do this projection, we can erase the -2 state, and the 2-photon state is described here now. And you can see it's a fully polarized state. And it's easy to measure it with a circular polarization base for the first photon and a horizontally polarized base for the second. And that's how the density, the two photon polarization density matrix should look like. And if we measure, if we do the projection onto the other state, the non-diagonal terms just flip sign. Okay? How do we do the measurement? I really have no time. I invite everybody here to our lab. It's a very relatively complicated and sophisticated lab, which enable us to do the main ideas here, which is that we can have six pulses in adjustable times, polarization, intensities, and colors. And at the same time, we can detect four single photons in two complementary polarization. Okay? And we can, the efficiency by which we detect photon is 1 out of 700. Okay? We can, next year we'll do it much better. We have a lot of money to buy better equipment, but that up to 2 years ago, that was the state of the art. I don't know of any other group that does it much better. Okay, so now how the equipment, the experiment goes. The first pulse excites the dark exciton here, okay, and generates its coherent superposition. The dark exciton decays to here, and then we convert it into a bi-exciton and wait for a photon to be emitted, and we detect the photon. 3/4 of a period later, we repeat this again, detect the emitted photon, and 3/4 of a period later, we repeat it again, and now use a polarized light to project the dark exciton spin. And you can see here, this is the detection signal. At the beginning, you see here, we have a depletion pulse, which kills the dark exciton from here. After this emission, there is a dark exciton in the system. We have to kill it in order to write it again. And we do this at 76 megahertz. Okay. Every 13 nanoseconds, we repeat this procedure. And we have four detectors. Each detector detects a signal like that. You can see here that the first two are not polarized. Here we do tomography. And this one is polarized. Here we do the projection. Okay. Now this is how it looks. So each detector detects photon at a rate of 100 kilohertz, 1 in 700 out of 76 megahertz. Now, when we want to correlate between two detectors, each one detects 1 over 700, then we can only find 1 in 700 squared less events in which we measure two photons, one in each detector. So the rate is now only 150 hertz. But you can see here two places where the first detector detects a time here and the second detector detects at this time. And the opposite, when the first one detects here and the second here. Okay, here, at this population, we do polarization tomography. Okay, and here we have three photons event. This is the time of the first detector, the second detector, and the third detector. At this, the six points, we pick up this point, we know the order of detection, and then we can do the polarization tomography. And this is the polarization tomography that we have performed, for example, for a projection on the plus two state, remember, non-diagonal terms, and projection to the minus two state, remember, non-diagonal terms at negative values. So, okay, I just try to summarize. This is a process map that Netanel described. We have to measure the process map in order to quantitatively say how good a measurement we have. And this is the unitary that Netanel showed, and this is our measured one. We can see that it's similar, but still different. With the process map, we can calculate the localizable entanglement. Okay? This is our calculation. Okay? The localizable entanglement is a function of the distance between the qubit. Okay, we can, so this is a calculation, and it shows that our device produces the cluster length is up to 5 qubits, and these are actual measurement. Okay, this is the measurement between the first and second photon when we project the dark exciton. This line agrees perfectly with the calculation, and this line is the degree of entanglement, negativity, as I mentioned, between a short chain like that. But remember, since we can't really project the dark excitation on three bases, only on two, this is a lower bound, and as seen here. And this is a two-qubit distance, entanglement between this DE and this photon when this one is measured. Okay, and it's also a lower bound. So let me just conclude. We demonstrated on-demand generation of a one-dimensional cluster state of polarization entangled photons. As an entangling qubit, we used the quantum dot confined dark exciton. Our prototype quantum dot device can produce strings of about 1,200 photons with entanglement lengths of about 5 photons. Longer entanglement lengths can be feasibly produced, and we propose and know how to do that. And we are currently working, one of my graduate students, Dan Kogan, on higher dimensionality cluster states. The work itself is now published at Science, at this article, research article, and it is featured by one of the prophets of the field, the one who suggested quantum computing by measurement, Briegel, at the same issue article. And you are all invited to read it. Last but not least, I have to thank all my collaborators, people who didn't have the pleasure to talk here today. First, Ido Schwartz and Dan Kogan, my two PhD students, who actually did most of this hard, demanding work. I'm done. Emma Schmigdal, which graduated, contributed tremendously to this work. Slava Don, who sits here, also helped out very much with all the calculations and simulation, and same Liron Gantz. Last but not least, Odette Kennett also helped us in difficult times when we had to analyze the tons of data that we had to measure. And I, and above, you can see a long-term collaborator of mine, Yossi Evron, who always sit above and make sure that we don't do mistakes. So before I conclude, I want to tell you that we are looking for excellent students and postdocs because this is a very demanding work, and we enjoy the benefit of a very luxurious grant from ERC, both me and Netanel, so we thank them as well, and we will be able to pay our postdocs tremendously. And last, thank you all for your attention.
Ben. You make this cavity.
Yes.
How do you know that the resonance of the cavity is a quantum dot?
That's a very good experimentalist question. So what we do, actually, in these samples, we grow the quantum dots. When we grow the quantum dots, we don't rotate our sample. And therefore, there is a gradient of density and composition and wavelengths of emission. Then when we grow the cavity, the mirror, we rotate it by 90 degrees, and we have a gradient of thicknesses in another direction. And after we have the sample, we find a place, and we look for quantum dots which are resonating very well with this kit. We find them.
Go ahead, and I have a silly question, but we laugh.
Well, I guess this is from Netanel. Can you actually begin measuring while knitting on the
other? Yeah. So you only could measure as you produce. You needed to have a thickness of 3 qubits. I don't remember the exact number. So
your prototype of 4 entangled is supposed to be sufficient for.
But you need to keep. Yeah, you need to. You don't need to keep all the photons alive and then measure.
Yeah.
You need to only keep a very short slab in order to measure it as you go, as you produce the.
So this 5 entangles is already sufficient.
The fact that the entanglement only persists 5 qubits means that each photon has an error. Not only, but you need to also do quantum error. You need to also include what's called quantum error correction.
The experimental problem is the ability to do multi-photon correlations. Okay, we suffer from this 1 in 700. So as you have seen, we cannot really measure real correlation between more than 3 photons currently. The next stage is we are buying better detectors that should increase our efficiency by a factor of 3 to 5, we hope. And if you talk about 4 photons, it's 3 in the power of 4, it's 81. So that's a different ballgame. So there's a lot of work still. Yes.
The experiment is done by you giving a pulse weight. This is what you do in the lab. Am I correct? Pulse.
But it's fast. You don't really wait.
No, okay. Between the first pulse and the second pulse, photon has been created. These are the photons that you will
Between
the first pulse that you give to the second pulse that you give, the system itself created a photon.
I don't understand what you're talking about.
The experiment works by you radiating your sample.
Right.
Forget about all the theory. You're sending pulses on your sample. The sample produced photons, and you measure the photon that the sample has produced.
Right.
Now, between the first and the second part, the photon has been produced, and it left the system.
Right.
How can we entangle with what happens next?
That's a question.
You are entangling two things that are not there at all. You know, one is already crossed the universe,
no,
and the other one is here.
It's a literature.
You are entangled. Doesn't decay with distance between us.
You are entangled to your predecessors, right? there was a paper by Yosef Bon and us, entanglement between generations. They don't have to be at the same time. Polarization entangled between two generations.
Okay, those of you who are left, let's thank Dudi. Let's see if there are any cake left, because Itzik was very quick to get out.